Well, good morning. My name is Jordan. I'm an intern here at Grace Saskatoon. Today, we're going to be continuing our look at the minor prophets, specifically the book of Zechariah, and the anticipation building up to the Messiah to come. To find the book of Zechariah, it might be helpful to find the book of Matthew in the New Testament and turn left past Malachi, and you'll find where we are today. We do have some Bibles up front here. If you don't have a Bible, please do take one. Follow along. The scriptures will be on the screen. Also, if you're here, maybe you're a younger teen or an adult who feels like a child sometimes, there are sheets up here, activity sheets that you can use throughout the service to take notes specifically tailored to you. I was looking them over the other day, and I thought, man, that's something I could use in service. Zechariah was a prophet from a family of priests that lived about 500 plus years before Jesus was born. He starts his ministry about 2 months after Haggai, where God gave Haggai a prophetic word challenging the people's priorities around fixing a broken down temple. God gave Zechariah a prophetic word about a coming priest that would fix a broken down sinful people. The beginning of the book records four different visions God gave Zechariah, calling God's people to return to him. You could consider Zechariah the revelation of the Old Testament, with the fantastic descriptions seen in these visions, one of which we're going to look at today. When we look at Zechariah 1:1, we get a brief picture of what the book is about. It says this, "In the eighth month, in the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to the prophet Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, the son of Iddo." Now, here we have the name of the prophet, his father, and his grandfather. Each man's name has a significant meaning. Zechariah's name means the Lord remembers. Each mention of his name reminded the prophet and the other people that God never forgets his people. As a side note, anytime in the Old Testament, a name ends with Iah, that's the name of the Lord, Yah, or Yahweh for short. At the end of the person's name, so whether it's Isaiah, Jeremiah, Hezekiah, Zechariah, so we get this idea that Zechariah's name means the Lord Yahweh remembers. The father of Zechariah, Berechiah, again, you see that name, Iah, means the Lord blesses. His grandfather's name, Iddo, means in time. So when we put all those names together, they provide us with a clue to the theme of this entire work. The Lord remembers and blesses at his set time. This is something to keep in mind as we look at this fourth vision that God gave Zechariah, found in Zechariah 3. If you were to look at your Bible or even your Bible app, you may notice that this section of Zechariah 3 is titled something like A Vision of Joshua, the High Priest. Now, please don't confuse us with Joshua from the Joshua in the Battle of Jericho. That man lived centuries and centuries before our Joshua, the high priest in this text. Our Joshua is one of 49,000 people that came back to Jerusalem from Babylon. And his job is high priest, and he represents all of God's people. This is the role that we'll see him fill in this incredible vision. So let's listen to the scripture video and dig in.
Reading from Zechariah chapter 3, verses 1 to 10. Then he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord and Satan, standing at his right hand to accuse him. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked from the fire?" Now Joshua was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments, and the angels said to those who were standing before him, "Remove the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "Behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you. I will clothe you with pure vestments." And I said, "Let them put a clean turban on his head." So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him with garments. And the angels of the Lord were standing by. And the angels of the Lord solemnly assured Joshua, "Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways and keep my charge, then you shall rule my house and have charge in my courts, and I will give you the right of access among those who are standing here. Hear now, O Joshua, the high priest, you and your friends who sit before you, for they are men who are assigned. Behold, I will bring my servants the branch. For behold, on the stone that I have set before you, Joshua, on a single stone with seven eyes, I will engrave its inscription, declared the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of this land in a single day. In that day, declares the Lord of hosts, every one of you will invite your neighbors to come under his vine and under his fig tree.
R.E.M. famously penned this song, Everybody Hurts. In doing so, they accurately sum up the human condition regarding rejection, loss, hurt, shame, and guilt, all in the catch-all phrase, everybody hurts sometimes, right? Now, there's no escaping guilt, not in any culture or any place. Whether you grew up in the church or not, if you're a part of this human race, guilt is a part of that experience at one point or another. Being guilty is objective. It means we're responsible for doing something wrong, harmful, or sinful. Feeling guilty is subjective. It means we feel ashamed or embarrassed for something we've done or something that has been done to us. Call it hormones or electrons firing in your brain, your conscience, Jiminy Cricket, the image of God. What's your response when this pang of guilt hits? We look at verse 1, and the first thing we learn is that the accuser wants us to feel hopeless when we're guilty. Here's what it says. Then he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. Now notice, Joshua isn't one of those bad Christians that binge watches Jeopardy on Netflix and only remembers the poor when the Sarah McLachlan sad songs play on the radio. No, he's a priest, a high priest, representing the people of God, standing before the angel of the Lord. And who's also there? Satan. This accuser is right there on his side, his right side of all places too. That's there for a reason. See, back in the day, if you were going to go to war, you traditionally draw your weapon or your strength with your right hand. Sorry, lefties, that's history. It's here we see this accuser, this father of lies, is pointing out the wickedness of Joshua's sinfulness. Joshua has nothing his own strength to draw from to combat these accusations. The Bible is clear that this accuser's defeat is sure, but his accusations ring day and night to those of us who put our faith in Jesus. In effect, the accuser is trying to say this about Joshua. There's no hope for him. He's guilty of sin. He can't serve God. What does this say about you, God, if you accept this wicked sinner? As Christians, we must expect that when we become dull to Jesus' justifying work on the cross, when we become conscious of sin, when we don't want to show grace or feel unfit to minister God's greatness, we must expect that the accuser is going to start to point fingers. I'm sure at any hour of any day, we could provide the accuser with enough evidence of his charges against us, for we are all guilty of sin. Even today, the accuser confronts us with the same hopelessness. Everyone seems to know each other. How is it possible to feel so alone in a crowd? If they really knew me, would they still accept me? I'm still struggling with sin. Do I even fit in? Is it worth trying? Now, when you look at this text, you'll notice Joshua, he doesn't defend himself. And it's here we're going to begin to see what the Christian's response to these accusations should be. See, it's God's desire that we not sin. But when we do sin, we have an advocate in Jesus. An advocate is someone who comes to our aid and pleads our case before a judge, a helper, an advisor, a counselor. In our court system, we call them lawyers. Someone who speaks on behalf of the client. We have this advocate because of Jesus' complete redemptive work in his death, burial, and resurrection. His body was broken for our sin and his blood shed for our debt that we might come into fellowship with God the Father. Listen to the angel of the Lord's response in verse 2. Take a look. And the angel of the Lord said to Satan, The Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this a brand plucked from the fire? The second thing I want you guys to see is that God wants us to feel sorrowful when we're guilty. See, God's electing love is really clear. Look at that. The Lord who has chosen. God is emphasizing to this accuser that this is my chosen one. I have chosen him. And as God has chosen to love Israel, to love Joshua, so has he chosen us who believe. Ephesians 1:4 says this, even as he chose us in him before the foundations of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. You see, it's God that justifies. But who has he chosen to justify? Us, a sin-contaminated people who, even at our personal best, as seen in Joshua, prepared for his priestly work, stand guilty before the Lord. Now pay attention. There's some good news coming. And it may not sound like it at first, but look at the screen at 2 Corinthians 7:10. It says this, for the kind of sorrow God wants us to experience leads away from sin and results in salvation. There's no regret for that kind of sorrow, but worldly sorrow, which lacks repentance, results in spiritual death. We get this picture of two different kinds of sorrow. In one, we see how God wants us to feel sorrowful when we're guilty. There's no regret to that kind of sorrow God wants us to experience. Why? It leads to us turning away from sin, often termed repentance, and results in salvation. What do you do when you're faced with the evidence of your failures? Do you self-medicate with endless hours of entertainment? Do you clean your house to show that you have some control over your life? Do you overindulge in food and drink because? Do you immerse yourself in your hobby, blocking out anyone else, ignoring your God-given responsibilities to shepherd and lead your home after all you've worked hard and deserved it? Yeah. Me. Guilty as charged. Now notice, there's a different kind of sorrow seen here. Worldly sorrow. Worldly sorrow is a knee-jerk reaction of a proud heart confronted with guilt. It's what happens when the roof of your delusion is ripped off and people see who you really are. And you still don't want to acknowledge that's who you really are. And ultimately, the scripture says that way leads to spiritual death. In verse 3, it says this, now Joshua was standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments. The third thing we learn here is that the accuser wants us to feel innocent when we're guilty. So Zechariah sees in this vision Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, wearing filthy garments to show the sin of Israel and the poverty into which they had fallen. We aren't talking about mere body odor and sweat. The word filthy here is used directly related to the Hebrew term used for Hebrew excrement, human excrement, sorry. Think about that. Joshua has showed up for work, dressed himself in his priestly clothes, believing he's prepared to serve and minister in the temple. He thinks he's a good person. Maybe that's enough. And yet, he is absolutely contaminated. This is another way the accuser will try to work when we're contaminated with sin. He'll try to convince us that we're innocent, even when there was great guilt in our lives. People often say, I don't need God. I'm perfectly happy without God. What they fail to realize is that happiness is not our greatest need. Our greatest need is forgiveness. Like Joshua, we may think we have the most accurate picture of ourselves, but our self-perception can be distorted by the brokenness of sin, like one of those funny mirrors at the exhibition. Perhaps maybe you've seen one at the circus. Did you ever walk past one? Have you ever seen the right reflection? See, that distorted reflection we see is one of the many reasons that we actively need a solid gospel community. It's not enough to merely have a place on Sunday where everybody knows your name and they're always glad you came. As much as I need community, after a long day on the road or in the office, the most common excuses that roll around in my head are, I had a busy day, I'm tired. I didn't eat supper, I'm hungry. You don't understand my kids' incredibly specific needs. Hear me, we need to be known. We need to be shown grace. We need to regularly open up the scriptures with others, to chew on, to be challenged by, to study. We need to be fed spiritually, and yeah, physically too. We need to pray and be prayed for. This is what gospel community does, and this is why we all need to be a part of one. The fourth thing we see is that God wants us to feel guilty when we're actually guilty. Look at verse 4 and 5. And the angel said to those who were standing before him, remove the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments. And verse 4, the word said is instructive. The Hebrew term is to answer, to respond. The word indicates a response to a request or a question, even though the request may not be explicitly spoken. In this case, we can assume that Joshua made a request of the Lord, namely, God, take this filth off me. Take away my guilt. Then God does what Joshua could never do in his own strength. He answers and orders those contaminated clothing to be removed. And how can God do this? Sin has to be dealt with. There's a price to be paid for forgiveness. I might back into your vehicle this afternoon, and you might even forgive me, but someone still has to pay for that repair. In forgiveness, Jesus pays the price, dealing with our condemnation, our shame, our guilt, once and for all. Look at the end of verse 4. Not only does God cleanse Joshua from sin, but he shows him that he's been cleansed. Behold, God says, Joshua is clean. Joshua is forgiven. Joshua is received as righteous. Joshua's new garments represent purity and holiness. They also signify his restoration and readiness to resume his ministry as a priest. Now Joshua is ready to resume his priestly work. His cleansing portrays perfectly the salvation and restoration that God brings to us sinners when we confess our sin and receive his forgiveness on the grounds of Jesus' perfect work on the cross. See, God wants us to feel guilty when we're actually guilty, because only then we will bring our guilt to him and be forgiven. But there's a question. Why Joshua? Why me? Why any of us? Psalms 18:19. He brought me out into a broad place. He rescued me because he delighted in me. He rescued you, not because you only use the good swear words like fiddlesticks, darn, and shoot. Not because your hair is an acceptable length. Not because of your upbringing. Not because of your education. Not because of your good reputation in the community. It doesn't say any of those things. It says, because he delighted in you. Think about that. This thought ought to daily drive us to our knees in wonder, in worship, in love, to be willing to lay aside anything, anything that would hold us back from knowing the person behind this great rescuing, Jesus, and the great grace he shows us. Do you see the love that Jesus extends to us? As long as we see our sin more satisfying than Jesus, we will not turn to him. In the end of verse 5, we see the angel of the Lord now on standby. What good news to know that when we struggle with sin, we have Jesus to turn to in an instant, who's ready to comfort us, who knows exactly what we're going through, who sees us at our worst, and loves us still. Biblical faith requires you to confess who you are. It doesn't require you to deny the reality of your brokenness of sin. When you accept and acknowledge who you actually are and say, "This is who I actually am," then you can rest in the grace of Jesus' completed work. Zechariah has shown us how God counters the accuser before we are cleansed of guilt. These last two points show us how the accuser deceives us and God tells us the truth after we've been forgiven. Look at verse 6 and 7. "And the angel of the Lord solemnly assured Joshua, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, keep my charge, then you shall rule my house and have charge over my courts, and I will give you the right of access among those who are standing here.'" My fifth point is that the accuser wants us to feel guilty when we are forgiven. After we have been forgiven, the accuser desires to make us feel guilty, to slow us down spiritually, and keep us from serving Jesus with the gladness that the release of forgiveness brings through his perfect work. In verse 7, the Hebrew word translated charge is extremely instructive regarding the Lord's intentions. It means to bear witness or to give testimony. Here the Lord is countering any lingering accusations by the accuser of Joshua's guilt. Now notice, the Lord's instruction isn't for Joshua to hide from others, avoid contact, and veg out until he feels better. The Lord's instruction isn't for Joshua to avoid regular gatherings until the guilt is really, really gone. No, one commenter puts it this way: Joshua and his fellow priests weren't put on probation. They were cleansed and restored to service. Joshua's cleansing had been given unconditionally when he repented. All he had to do was turn and receive the gift of forgiveness that was already his in Jesus. The Lord isn't saying in this passage that if Joshua obeys, he's forgiven. The Lord is calling Joshua to pursue this holiness, to walk in his ways, to be sanctified in response to his being forgiven first. What we do see here is that the Lord is saying to Joshua that his effectiveness and usefulness as a priest is conditional. After you have been forgiven, if you walk in my ways, then. And so it is with us. There's a scripture in 2 Thessalonians 2:13. It says this. It's on the screen. "But we ought always to give thanks to God for you, brothers, beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as the first fruits to be saved through sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. For those who put their faith in Christ, guilt isn't condemnation that you aren't saved, but proof that you're being sanctified or set apart by the Spirit of God so that you may be more effective in your Christian walk and useful in those places of ministry in everyday life that God has placed you." During this message prep, I somehow ended up reading this military medical journal on the long-term health outcomes on war-related amputations. Now, it caught my eye because it has this portion on phantom limb pain. See, the soldiers would go to war, and using your imaginations, you can guess how a loss of limb would occur. But it said that at least 85% of the folks in this study reported this phantom limb pain. Though the extremity was gone, something in them said it still hurt. This journal gives us a unique insight on how the accuser wants us to feel guilty when we're actually forgiven. See, the power of sin is broken, but the presence of sin still remains. As Christians, we can be obsessed over past sins. All it takes is one of those awkward chance encounters with a person who previously wronged me, and those feelings of unforgiveness begin to well up. If I'm not careful, after I've left that chance encounter, my mind begins to go and I begin to think of what I really should have said or what I really could have done. But see, this is exactly what the accuser wants. He will bring up our past. He will bring up our failures. He will bring people into our lives to discourage us. Thus, our need for ongoing sanctification. Or you could say it this way. We need to daily pursue small gains in our spiritual life. How we start doing this is as practical as taking one scripture verse to chew on during the day, or even praying before we get out of bed. I need this reminder because it's so easy in my life to get busy and think that I can do it on my own. But really all it shows is how self-sufficient I am, when in reality, I'm in need of daily transformation by the Spirit of God. How good are we at denying or ignoring our need for grace? Hiding was Adam and Eve's default response when they fell under the condemnation of their guilt from sin. In those times, may we see what Zechariah saw. God's people transformed from filthiness to cleanliness. May we see ourselves as sinners, saved by grace, wearing the righteous garments of our Savior Jesus, standing confidently in our forgiveness that he has purchased for us at such a great price. We are truly forgiven. Verses 8 and 10 says this, "Hear now, O Joshua, the high priest, you and your friends who sit before you, for they are men who are a sign. Behold, I will bring my servant the branch." The sixth lesson that we see here is that God wants us to feel forgiven when we are forgiven. The Lord ends the vision by telling Joshua and his fellow priests that they are a sign of things to come. The word sign indicates a symbol of prophetic significance. The name Joshua or Yeshua in the original language itself is a sign, as it's the Hebrew form of the name Jesus. Joshua is pointing us towards a coming Messiah, a greater high priest. This scripture gives Jesus two titles, my servant and the branch. Jesus is a very different king, a servant king, who came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And like a branch, his kingdom of ransomed sinners would grow and spread throughout the world, gathering a people. As we look at verse 9, we're met with Jesus being described as a stone. We're told that this stone has 7 eyes. Now, I told you at the beginning that this vision had some fantastic descriptions. These eyes are simply describing the attributes of the coming Messiah. This Messiah, Jesus, would be full of wisdom, would see and know all, and would judge with perfection and fullness. But this isn't the first time Jesus has been described as a stone. No, elsewhere in the Old and New Testament, Jesus is described as a cornerstone, a rejected stone, a stumbling stone, a stone that fills the whole earth and crushes evil, a stone upon which we are to build our lives, a stone upon which Jesus himself builds his church. Then the Lord promises to engrave an inscription on a stone. Well, how else do you engrave into a stone unless you first have the right tools? Like say a hammer, something sharp. What has been engraved into that stone? Our names. Our names were engraved into the palms of Jesus' hands. Do you remember that portion of scripture we covered in John? Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." This Christmas season, we celebrate Jesus taking on human form for the purpose that he might be engraved upon. He bears those scars to this day as proof of what he has done. In the end of verse 9, we see that on a single day, that day on the cross where Jesus bore our sins, dying in our place, on that single day, he removed our iniquity. This was an instantaneous work by our great high priest, our great Joshua, Jesus. Friends, his work is truly finished. Through Jesus, this Messiah, this servant, this branch, this stone, God has made a way for his people to overcome the accusation of the accuser and the condemnation of sin, and in doing so experience what the Apostle Paul describes as having our conscience purged of dead works, that we may serve the living God and enjoy the freedom of not just being forgiven, but feeling forgiven. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I ask that we'd recognize the forgiveness of our greater need, that we would seek you. Lord, please use this message to bring glory to your name, joy to your people, and salvation to the lost. May you be lifted up as we celebrate your great work together. Lord, we are truly forgiven. Thank you for what you've done. Amen.